Hey guys, welcome back. I am Ashish and today we will be continuing with Chester Barnard. This is the part 2 of the session. If you have not watched the part 1, I would request you to go back and watch that. Link for the same would be in the description of this video. So we will be continuing with some of the left out parts of Chester Barnard that we have left yesterday. So continuing with the miscellaneous topics, we will learn about 3 miscellaneous topics and then we will move on to our last topic, that is the functions of the executive that Chester Barnard has given us. So miscellaneous topic, the first miscellaneous topic that we will learn about is communication. What Barnard has said about communication, we'll see. Organization as a cooperative system is held together by the ability of contributors to communicate with each other, and this we have seen also in our previous session. If you remember, 3 elements of formal organization, what were the 3 elements? First one was common purpose, second one was willingness to serve, and third one was communication. So cooperative system is held together by effective communication. If you are able to communicate, then the cooperative system will be held together. Barnard therefore called attention to the fact that a common purpose must be commonly known, and to be known must be in some way communicated. So what is a common purpose of an organization? Which everyone in an organization knows about, right? That is why it is a common purpose. The goal of the organization that the organization has to achieve, wo organization ka common purpose hota hai, right? So common purpose tabhi hoga jab wo commonly known hoga sabko. So a common purpose must be commonly known, and how will it be commonly known? It must be in some way communicated. Agar aap usko communicate करोगे अच्छे से, तभी तो आपके ऑर्गेनाइजेशन का गोल आपके मेंबर्स को पता होगा, राइट? सो अ कॉमन पर्पस मस्ट बी कॉमनली नोन, एंड टू बी नोन इट मस्ट बी इन सम वे कम्युनिकेटेड. दिस इज व्हाई कम्युनिकेशन इज इंपॉर्टेंट. दिस इज व्हाट चेस्टर बर्नार्ड सेज. विद सम एक्सेप्शंस, वर्बल कम्युनिकेशन बिटवीन मैन इज द मेथड बाय विच इट इज अकम्प्लिश्ड. सो अगर सबसे इफेक्टिव मेथड ऑफ कम्युनिकेशन आपको अगर कुछ बोलना है, वो है वर्बल कम्युनिकेशन. आप ईमेल से कितना भी कम्युनिकेट कर लो, दैट विल बी नॉट दैट इफेक्टिव एज वर्बल कम्युनिकेशंस आर. So verbal communications are always more effective than non-verbal communications. This is what Chester Barnard says. So I hope it is clear to you why communication is important in an organization. Barnard regards communication as an important condition for the existence of an organization. Obviously, right? Only by keeping communication channels open, the executive can transmit the purpose of the organization to the employees and learn their needs. We have seen this. Transmit the purpose of the organization, जो organization का goal होता है, the organization goal or the organization objective, if you have to transmit that to your members, you need communication, right? So only by keeping communication channels open, you can transmit the purpose of the organization, and also you can learn about your employees' needs. Unki needs ko learn karna zaruri hai to satisfy them, right? We have learnt about this contribution satisfaction equilibrium. So try to relate everything. Try to relate everything that we have learnt till now. So to learn their needs, it is important to have communication channels in an organization. So why communication is important? To transmit the purpose of the organization and to learn the needs of the employees. More than anything else, communication determines how much authority a leader shall exercise over his subordinates. This also we have seen in our previous session. What is authority? Authority is based on the acceptance that we have learned, that Chester Barnard said. It is the basis of acceptance that gives you authority. So if your communication is accepted by the subordinate, only then you have the authority over that subordinate. So communication also determines how much authority a leader shall exercise over his subordinates. So this is why communication is important, and this is why communication is an important condition for the existence of an organization, because everything depends on communication. Some basic principles that ensure effectiveness of communication. Now we'll see how to make communications more effective. So there are some basic principles, and these are very, very obvious. We do not need to discuss much about it, but still we'll see what these are. But these are very, very obvious principles. First one is the channel of communication should be definitely known. As a subordinate, aapko pata hona chahiye ki aapko manager ko kis tarah contact karna hai. So it should be known to me that how should I contact my supervisor. So channels of communication should be definitely known, either via email or either I should go directly into his cabin or whatever way. So channels of communication should be definitely known to all in the organization. Objective authority requires a definite formal channel of communication to every member of organization. So there should be a definite formal channel of communication to every member of organization. So har member of organization ke paas ek definite formal channel of communication hona chahiye, which comes from the manager to them for the objective authority. What is the objective authority? The general kind of authority which is applicable to all. If we have to give some order which is applicable to all, there should be a definite formal channel which gives this order to everyone. For example, an email. As a manager, if you send out an email to all of your employees, that is a definite formal channel of communication to pass an objective authority, a general order that you have to give to your employees. So an objective authority requires a definite formal channel of communication to every member of organization. organization. Very simple, right? The third is the line of communication must be as direct or as short as possible, because the more longer the line of communication gets, the more distorted the information becomes, because it has to pass through that many levels, right? So utne level pass karte karte information distort ho jati hai. So communication ki jo line hoti hai, that should be as short or as direct as possible to keep the communication intact, to keep the communication distortion free. So it should be as direct or as short as possible. And what is the best way? We have seen this in our previous point. The best way is verbal communication. Isse short to kuch ho hi nahi sakta, right? So this is the shortest and the best way. Verbal communication is the best way of communicating. The fourth is the complete line of communication should usually be used. So aapki jo bhi complete line of communication hai with all the levels between them, that complete line of communication should be used. You should not skip levels. Aisa nahi hai ki aap pun ho to aap apne manager ko skip karke seedha CEO ko aap complain karoge. You should not do this, right? So every level, whatever the line of communication has been established, however long it is, it should always usually be used, except obviously in case of emergencies or such situations. So usme aap skip kar sakte ho, but usually however long the communication line is, that should usually always be used. But try to keep it as short as possible. Agar long bhi hai to bhi usko as it is use karo. You should not skip any levels of communication line. So complete line of communication should usually be used. The fifth is the competence of the persons serving as communication centers, that is officers or supervisory heads, must be adequate. So jo competence level hota hai, the person that is handling the communication at that particular level, that competence of that person should be adequate. ऐसा नहीं है कि उसको बिठा दिया उसको पता ही नहीं है क्या करना है. So competence of that person should be adequate who is serving as the communication center, whatever the officers are, whatever the supervisory heads are, who are relaying the communication to other levels, those should be of adequate competence. The sixth is the line of communication should not be interrupted during the time when an organization is to function. तो आपको जो line of communication है उसको interrupt नहीं करना है जब organization function कर रही है तब. Just because you have to implement or pass some order very quickly, you cannot fire two or three people from that line of communication. So that line of communication should not be interrupted during the time when the organization is to function. So agar organization kaam nahi kar rahi hai aur fir aap communication line mein changes kar rahe ho to theek hai, kyunki organization us time pe kaam nahi kar rahi hai. But organization kaam kar rahi hai aur fir bhi aap communication line mein changes kar rahe ho to it is not good. It should not be interrupted. It's not hard and fast rule to follow all of these. These are just some basic principles that you should follow to make your communication more effective. If you do not follow any of these principles, it's not like that your communication will not be effective. It might even be effective. It might even be more effective. You never know. But it is always better to follow all these things. It is always better to follow the complete line of communication, to have a proper chain of communication and everything. The last one is every communication should be authenticated. So it should be an authentic communication. It should be an original information or original authentic order that you are passing on, and not based on some rumors. For example, every organization has informal organization inside them, right? We have learned this in our previous session. So what happens is informal organization mein kabhi kabhi rumors bhi spread ho jate hain. Grapevine communication. If you do not know about this, we'll learn about grapevine communication in our third module, that is administrative behavior. Do not worry about it. What grapevine communication is, main aapko kuch bolunga, aap kuch samjhoge, aap kisi aur ko kuch aur bologe, wo kuch aur samjhega, wo kisi aur ko kuch aur bolega. So it's like something is getting distorted along the way. So it becomes grapevine. Wo fir ek rumor ban jati hai more than an original information. So every communication should be authenticated. This is the last principle. I hope the concept of communication as given by Chester Barnard is clear to you. So it is a very simple concept, very very simple concept, and Chester Barnard has said us that this is why communication is important. So moving on to our next miscellaneous topic, that is responsibility, morality and conflicts. Now we have dealt about what authority is, right? Acceptance basis theory, right? So agar authority ke sath deal kiya hai to responsibility ke sath bhi deal kiya hi hoga. So we will see what Chester Barnard has said about responsibility now. Along with authority, Barnard examines responsibility in greater detail. He examines responsibility from the point of view of morality. Now see this, understand this, that he has taken a very different view from all the other thinkers. Har koi ye view nahi leta hai, right? Authority he has examined from the view of acceptance as the basis. Responsibility he is examined from the point of view of morality. Not everyone has examined responsibility from the point of morality or authority from the point of acceptance as the basis, right? So he has taken a very very different view of all the things. So this is how Chester Barnard is important. Try to remember these things. This will help you in exam. you will realize this when we'll discuss 2015 UPSC question, why it is important to understand some things and not learn by heart some things. Okay, so try to understand and relate these things that responsibility has examined from the point of view of morality. So please pay close attention to this. He defines responsibility as the power of a particular private code of morals. So aapke jo private code of morals hote hai na, jo aapke private moral codes, moral code of ethics hote hai, so whatever your morals are, the power of these morals to control the conduct of the individuals in the presence of strong contrary desires or impulses. तो आप जो भी conduct करते हो, आप जो भी behavior कर रहे हो, if those behaviors of you, of those conducts that you are conducting, if all these things are controlled by your moral codes, then you have the responsibility in the presence of strong contrary desires or impulses. So we'll take an example for this. Let's say you are an IAS officer or a civil servant and someone comes to you and asks you to take the bribe. Now as a person, as a human being, you might be having this moral code that no, I will never take bribe in my life, I will never do any wrong things in my life. So ye aapke khud ke kuch morals honge, right? To wo morals jab aapke conduct ko control karte hain, when you neglect that bribe, when you reject that bribe and tell to that person, no, I will not take bribe, it is against my moral code of ethics. So when you do that, that is when you are responsible. Responsibility ka baat hi hai. When do you become responsible? When your own morals control your conduct, control your behavior, that is when you become responsible. That is how you become responsible. This is what Chester Barnard said. What responsibility is? It is the power of private code of morals to control the conduct of individuals in the presence of strong contrary desires of or impulses. So whatever contrary desires or impulses are, agar uske chalte bhi, agar aapke morals aapka behavior control kar pa rahe hain, then you are responsible. This is what responsibility is. So if you have to become a responsible person, start listening to your moral code of conduct. That is what Chester Barnard says. Okay, so responsibility is not determined by any one single moral code, but by a complex set of moral, legal, technical, professional and institutional code. To koi ek single moral code nahi hota, it's a complex code. And it's not only just moral code, sare code hote hain, legal, technical, professional, jo aapko guide karte hain, theek hai. For example, let's say koi ek moral code, single moral code nahi hota, like main bribe nahi lunga, main murder nahi karunga, main kidnap nahi karunga. This is not just one code, right? There is a set of complex code. Main koi galat kaam nahi karunga, main kisi ko marunga nahi, kisi ko pitunga नहीं, मैं गाली नहीं दूंगा. सम कोड्स होते हैं, कुछ मॉरल कोड्स होते हैं. सो देयर इज नॉट वन सिंगल मॉरल कोड, देयर इज अ कॉम्प्लेक्स सेट ऑफ moral codes, and also there is a complex set of moral, legal, technical. So sare codes hote hain. I will not evade taxes, this is not the moral code. Evasion of taxes is a legal code. You will not evade taxes because there is a legal law for that, right? So this is a complex set of everything. So responsibility is not determined by just one single moral code. You do not become responsible by just not taking bribe. You become responsible when you do not evade taxes, when you do not take bribe, when you do not do any of these things that are prohibited by these codes. Theek hai, to responsibility does not come by one single code, it is very complex thing. So responsibility is defined as a very complex set of codes that control your conduct or control your behavior. Okay, I hope this is clear to you what he has said about responsibility from the point of view of morality. I hope this is clear to you. Therefore these codes always regulate the working of organization. To ye jo sare code hote hain, these always regulate the working of organizations. In this process of regulation, the internal moral sanction of individuals is more effective than the external sanctions. To aap external sanctions kitne bhi laga do, agar aapke internal moral sanctions utne strong nahi hain, to वो उतने इफेक्टिव नहीं होंगे. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, लेट्स से दैट इंटरनली यू फील दैट किलिंग पीपल इज ओके, किलिंग पीपल इज नॉट बैड. दैट इज वॉट इंटरनली यू फील. सो हाउ मच एवर एक्सटर्नल सेंक्शन आप लगा दो कि मर्डर करने पे यू विल गेट 7 years ऑफ इम्प्रिजनमेंट और यू विल गेट डेथ सेंटेंस, तो आप कितने भी एक्सटर्नल सेंक्शन लगा दो, दैट विल नॉट बी दैट इफेक्टिव. ठीक है, इफेक्टिव होंगे तो भी उतने इफेक्टिव नहीं होंगे जितना आपके इंटरनल मॉरल सेंक्शंस होंगे. योर इंटरनल मॉरल सेंक्शंस आर ऑलवेज मोर इफेक्टिव देन द एक्सटर्नल सेंक्शंस. आई होप दिस इज क्लियर टू यू. दिस इज वॉट चेस्टर बर्नार्ड सेड अबाउट इंटरनल सेंक्शंस. सेंक्शंस मीन्स रेस्ट्रिक्शंस. आई होप दिस यू नो. Sanctions means restrictions. So whatever internal restrictions you have due to your own moral codes, that is more effective than the external restrictions. Since individual conduct or behavior is governed by a complex of codes, it may result in conflicts. This is particularly so with codes having substantially equal validity. So what happens is, if there are two codes which are equally valid for you, or agar aisa koi situation aa jata hai when these both of these equally valid codes are at conflict, and that is when conflicts arise. Let's take an example again. Same example, you are an IAS officer, someone comes to you to give the bribe, and your supervisor also tells you to take the bribe. Now let's say that you have two set of moral codes. One is that I will never take any bribe, and second is I will never disobey my supervisor. This is the moral code that you have. Let's say, for an example, there are two moral codes: I will not take any bribe and I will never disobey my supervisor. So these are two equally valid moral codes that you have, and now they are at conflict. Your supervisor is asking you to take bribe, but you do not want to take bribe, and these codes are at conflict. Disobeying the supervisor and taking the bribe, these codes are at conflict now. So what will happen is it will result in conflicts. So relate this with other thinkers. What other thinkers have dealt with is conflicts between management and employees. What Chester Barnard says about conflicts is he talks about internal conflict, jo aapke moral codes ke wajah se jo conflict hota hai na, he talks about those conflicts. So this is how conflicts dealt by Chester Barnard is different. Always try to relate things. So it may result in conflicts, and especially when particularly with the codes having substantially equal validity, and such conflicts may result in kya parinam hoga aise conflicts ka. These may result in first thing, it may result in paralysis of action. Jo aap action lene wale ho, wo aap nahi le paoge. So there will be a paralysis of action accompanied by emotional tension. But obvious, right? Agar aapke do moral codes at conflict hain, to aap wo kaam kar hi nahi paoge jo aap kaam karne wale ho, kyunki aapko pata hi nahi ab kya karna hai. Rishwat leni hai ya supervisor ko mana karna hai ya kya karna hai, aapke dono code at conflict hain. Agar aap rishwat le loge to aapka wo code invalid ho jayega, aur agar aap supervisor ko mana kar doge to aapka wo wala code invalid ho jayega. Supervisor ko aap disobey kar doge, right? So आपके दोनों कोड एट कॉन्फ्लिक्ट हैं, तो आप क्या करोगे? इट इज अ पैरालिसिस ऑफ एक्शन नाउ, एंड दिस विल बी अकंपनीड बाय इमोशनल टेंशन, एंड दिस विल एंड इन अ सेंस ऑफ फ्रस्ट्रेशन, ब्लॉकेड, अनसर्टेनिटी, और अ लॉस ऑफ डिसाइसिवनेस, और अ लैक ऑफ कॉन्फिडेंस. तो ये सारी चीजें हो जाएंगी. पहले तो आपको इमोशनल टेंशन होगा, एक्शन नहीं ले पाओगे, और एंड में आपको फ्रस्ट्रेशन हो जाएगी, डिसअपॉइंटमेंट हो जाएगी, डिप्रेशन में चले जाओगे, कॉन्फिडेंस आपका गिर जाएगा, एंड डिसाइसिवनेस आपका डिसीजन मेकिंग पावर कम हो जाएगी. तो ये सारी चीजें हो जाती हैं व्हेन यू आर एट कॉन्फ्लिक्ट्स, व्हेन यू आर एट क्रॉस रोड्स. ठीक है, अगर आप क्रॉस रोड्स पे हो विद रिस्पेक्ट टू योर ओन कोड्स, दिस इज व्हाट हैपेंस. दिस इज द फर्स्ट थिंग दैट माइट हैपन. इंटरनल कॉन्फ्लिक्ट का ये पहला रिजल्ट है, दैट माइट हैपन. सेकंड थिंग दैट माइट हैपन इज देयर इज कन्फर्मेंस ऑफ वन कोड एंड वायलेशन ऑफ अदर. तो अगर आपको अपना कॉन्फ्लिक्ट तोड़ना है, तो आपको एक को वायलेट करना पड़ेगा, एक कोड को वायलेट करना पड़ेगा और दूसरे कोड को कन्फर्म करना पड़ेगा. आइदर यू हैव टू लिसन टू योर सुपरवाइजर एंड टेक द ब्राइब, और इफ यू आर नॉट टेकिंग द ब्राइब, यू विल हैव टू डिसओबे योर सुपरवाइजर. सो वन और द अदर कोड हैज टू बी वायलेटेड इफ यू आर नॉट paralyzing your action, otherwise your action will be paralyzed. If you are not paralyzing your action, violation of one of the other code will happen, and it is but obvious that it will happen, and this will result in a sense of guilt. आपको अंदर से guilty feeling होगी कि यार कुछ तो गलत कर दिया, right? So this will result in a sense of guilt, discomfort, dissatisfaction or a loss of respect. तो ये सब चीजें हो जाती हैं. तो third चीज that might happen is there is found some substitute action which satisfies immediate desire or impulse or interest or dictates of one code and yet confirms टू ऑल अदर कोड्स. तो तीसरी चीज आप कर सकते हो कि कुछ आप मिडल पाथ निकाल लो, अ सब्स्टिट्यूट एक्शन विच सेटिस्फाइज एवरीथिंग, विच डज नॉट एग्जैक्टली वायलेट द अदर कोड कंप्लीटली. ठीक है, कंप्लीट वायलेशन नहीं होगा. तो एक मिडल पाथ होता है जो आपकी पर्सनल चीज है उसको आप इंटैक्ट रख रहे हो, और आप दूसरी कोड को भी आप पूरी तरह से वायलेट नहीं कर रहे. तो दिस इज सम मिडल पाथ दैट यू हैव फाउंड आउट. सो दीज आर द थ्री थिंग्स दैट कैन हैपन: पैरालिसिस ऑफ एक्शन, कन्फर्मेंस ऑफ वन एंड वायलेशन ऑफ अदर, एंड द थर्ड थिंग इज सब्स्टिट्यूट एक्शन और मिडल path that you are finding out which is confirms to all of the other codes and does not violate completely all of the codes. Okay, so this is what he has to say about responsibility, morality and conflicts. Responsibility he has seen from the point of view of morality. Agar aap ek moral person ho, moral insan ho, to aap responsible insan ho. And not only moral, bahut sare complex code hote hain. Responsibility has defined from the point of view of morality and all other codes, and from the conflict of these moral codes arises the internal conflicts which he has dealt about. So I hope this is clear to you. Now moving on to our third miscellaneous topic, Barnard on decision making. Now this is a very important contribution by Chester Barnard, and not most of the books have dealt with this, so please pay attention to this. Barnard was most notable for his contribution to decision making. He viewed an organization as a system of decision making as well as communication. So he was most notable for his contribution on decision making. He was one of the first to study the process of decision making in organizations. Problems requiring analysis and decision making surface in various ways. Barnard suggests the following origins of occasions for decision. So what are the occasions that you take decisions in? Barnard says that following are the origins of occasions. So what occasions you take decisions in? First is authoritative authoritative communications from supervisor. What are authoritative communications? Nothing but orders. Okay. So whatever orders that you are receiving from supervisors, when you receive those orders, as a subordinate, you will take decision whether you have to follow that order or not. This is what you have seen acceptance as the basis of theory of authority, right? So whenever you receive authoritative orders or communications from supervisor, as a subordinate, you take this decision whether you have to follow that order or not. So this is the first occasion that you take decision when you receive authoritative communication from supervisors. Second is cases referred for decision by subordinates. So when you refer cases to your managers will now take decision on that case referred by you. So that is, managers are taking decision on that case referred by their subordinates. So first is, as a subordinate, you take decision when supervisors give you orders. And second is, supervisors take decision when you refer some case to them. Third is, cases originating in the initiative of the executive concerned. So whatever executive or manager are there, they take the decision on their own initiative. This is the third case. First is, as a subordinate, you take decision. Second is, manager take decision when you refer some case to them. Third is, managers on their own initiative, they take the decisions. And these are the three origins of occasions that Chester Barnard says are in general occasions when people take decisions. So I hope this is clear to you, occasions when people take decisions. Then while making decisions, the decision maker, whoever the decision maker is, whether it is subordinate or whether it is supervisor, whoever the decision maker is, whoever they're taking the decision, while making decisions, the decision maker should take into account only the relevant factors or parts affecting the organizations and leave the irrelevant and hostile parts. This is but obvious, right? If you take any decision, then you consider only relevant things consider the decision loge, and you irrelevant things consider nahi karoge. This is what also Chester Barnard says, that as a decision maker, whenever you are taking any decision, you should only take relevant factors into consideration and leave out all the irrelevant or hostile parts out of that decision. So this is what you should do. For this purpose, the decision maker is required to analyze the situation. Or agar aapko relevant cheezon ko consider karna hai, if you have to find out only the relevant parts, you have to analyze the situation to determine the strategic factors, the relevant factors, jo bhi strategic or relevant factors hai, unko determine karne ke liye, aapko situation ko analyze karna padega. So this is what is your job. While making decision, while taking decisions, you should be able to analyze the situation. This is what Chester Barnard says. Barnard says that decision making in an organization is much more logical and rational than an individual making personal decisions. Now he makes a distinction between a person who is taking a personal decision outside an organization and the same person who is taking a decision inside an organization. What Chester Barnard says is, inside organization aap jo bhi decision lote ho, wo jyada logical aur jyada rational hota hai, as compared to when you are taking your personal decision, because personal decisions are taken by heart and not by brain most of the time. Okay, I'm talking about most of the time personal decisions are taken by heart and not by brain. And at the same time, while you are taking a decision in an organization, you have to consider various things. It is very calculated decision that you are taking, right? So a decision taken in an organization is much more logical and rational than a person who is taking a personal decision. This is what Chester Barnard says. The reason is that, he gives the reason also, the reason is that former is the result of deliberation, calculation and thought. So aap jo organization mein decision le rahe ho, that is the result of deliberation, calculation and thought. And while the latter is the result of subconscious, automotive and responsive forces. आप दिल से डिसीजन लेते हो, तो दिस इज मोर ऑफ अ सबकॉन्शियस डिसीजन दैट यू आर टेकिंग व्हाइल यू आर मेकिंग अ पर्सनल डिसीजन. सो दिस इज मोर ऑफ अ सबकॉन्शियस एंड ऑटोमोटिव एंड रिस्पॉन्सिव फोर्सेस. आप रिस्पॉन्स करोगे, आप गुस्से में डिसीजन ले लोगे, और दीस थिंग्स व्हाइल यू आर टेकिंग डिसीजन इन ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, सच थिंग्स डू नॉट हैपन. यू डेलिब्रेट, यू कैलकुलेट एंड यू थिंक अबाउट इट एंड ओनली देन यू टेक डिसीजन. एंड दिस इज व्हाई decisions taken in an organization are more logical and rational than the personal decisions. I hope this is clear to you. Barnard contends that social and psychological factors too have a significant effect on decisions. So जो social factors होते हैं, psychological factors होते हैं, उनका भी effect होता है decisions पे. Whatever the society is undergoing right now, that will have an effect on you as an employee of that organization. अगर बाहर society में आपके organization के बारे में गलत चीज़ें बताई जा रही हैं, that will affect the decisions that you take inside the organization. So everything has an effect on decisions, social and psychological factors too. And remember this, this will use in our 2015 UPSC question also, which was a very tricky question. This point we will use in their social and psychological factors. Barnard speaks of the natural human reluctance to decide or to make decisions. Even when they have adequate facts, some people will try to avoid making decisions because making of decisions is a burdensome task. We have seen this in our fiction of authority topic In previous session, if you remember, we have discussed about why fiction of authority is necessary. It is necessary because it helps you in delegating the task upward, because people do not want to take decision themselves. This is why it is important to have a fiction of authority so that the managers can take decision. And this is what Chester Barnard says here also. He speaks about the natural human reluctance to decide or make decision. As a human being, as an individual, we always try to avoid responsibility. Humko responsibility nahi chahiye, humko sirf paisa de do, bas kaam khatam, hai na? So we always try to avoid responsibility, and that is why we avoid taking decisions, because taking decisions is a huge task. Everyone or someone depends on the decision that you have taken. It is a decision, right? So someone depends on the decision that you have taken. So it is a big task. It is a responsible task. So human nature hota hai. This is a basic human tendency. Everyone has this, that we avoid taking decisions, because making of decisions is a burdensome task. I hope the decision making concept as given by Chester Barnard is clear to you. So moving on now, we'll see the functions of the executive. If you remember, this was the name of his book that we are studying, Functions of the Executive. He gave this book in 1938. Now we'll study what actually functions of the executive Chester Barnard suggested. So in organizations, executives perform various functions necessary to ensure coordination of the cooperative system. So cooperative system ko barkarar rakhne ke liye ek organization mein executive bahut sare function karta hai, theek hai? They also act as channels of communication. This is also one of the functions. They also act as channel of communication. However, all the work undertaken by them, according to Barnard, is not executive work. To jo executive ka executive work hota hai is not the every work that he is undertaking. For example, a vice chancellor giving classroom lectures, or a manager selling the products. So these are some things that a manager does not have to do. A manager does not have to sell products. That is, his subordinates will do that, right? But let's say there is some emergency or some contingency that manager has to step in and he has to sell products, but still he is doing that, but still do not consider that as his executive work. Wo uske work definition mein nahi aata hai, right? It is not his work that he has to do. He is doing it because the situation is demanding it, but it is not his executive work. Remember this, not all the work undertaken by executives is executive work. So what is executive work then? To Barnard, executive work involves a specialized work of maintaining the organization in operation. So organization ko operation mein rakhna, ye aapka executive work hai. Not selling products and everything. Your organization should be in operation. This is the executive work that an executive has to perform. The executive functions are like those of the nervous system, including the brain, in relation to the rest of the body. So like how nervous system and brain keeps your body in function and operation, right? So this is the work of executive also. Just like the nervous system, if your brain becomes dead, then your body will stop functioning. So this is how, if the executives become dead, the organization will also stop functioning. So this is the work of executive, to keep the organization in operation. This is the executive work, and not selling the products and not giving classroom lectures and all these things. So executive work is a specialized work. There are three essential executive functions as stated by Barnard. So ye executive work hai kya, ye Barnard batate hain. He says that there are three executive functions which are essential that every executive has to perform. No matter what, you have to perform these three executive functions. So first of these is maintenance of an organization communication. So organization ka jo communication channel hai, communication hai jo organization ka, usko maintain karna aapka pehla essential kaam hai. There are three essential functions. First of those is maintaining the organization communication, because communication is very important. We have studied this in our miscellaneous topic, right? If you remember, this function has three important phases. First phase is defining the scheme of organization. What is scheme of organization? This means defining the organizational positions, specifying the duties, division of labor, or asap define karne ke baad, convey this to employees. So this is the first phase of maintaining communication. And we have learned this in communication also, if you remember, transmitting the purpose of the organization. Jo organization ka goal hota hai, agar aapko usko commonly known karna hai, a common goal should be commonly known, and for that it should be communicated. So to transmitting the common goal of the organization, you have to be effective communicator. So the first phase is defining the scheme of organization, and scheme of organization consists of all of these things: organization position, organization goals and organization purposes and duties of each and every individual, and convey this to your employees. This is the first phase of organization communication. Second phase is maintaining a personnel system. This is nothing but recruiting men who have appropriate qualifications, offering incentives, promotion, demotion, dismissal. So ye sara personal system ko maintain karna aapka second kaam hai, which comes under organization of communication. So this is the personal system that you are maintaining, the second phase of communication. The third phase of communication is securing an informal organization. So every formal organization organization inside has an informal organization, right, which makes it more strong, which makes it more bonding and everything. So it is your job as a part of maintenance of organization communication, it is your job to secure this informal organization also. So these are the three important phases of communication which you have to maintain as an executive. Please remember this. And the first two phases of scheme of organization and personal system, these first two phases are complementary and they depend on each other. I hope this is clear to you. The first essential executive function is maintenance of organization communication. There are three essential executive functions. We'll now learn about the second thing. Second is securing the essential service from individuals. This is nothing but ensuring the contribution of your employees. Aapke jo bhi employees hain, unka contribution aap ensure karo. This is nothing but securing the essential services from individuals, because only when they contribute the organization will function, right? And you have to keep the organization in operation. Agar organization ko function mein rakhna hai, operation mein rakhna hai, so you will have to secure coordination and cooperation from your members. So this is the securing the essential services from the individuals. It has two main aspects. Now communication has three phases and this essential services has two main aspects. The first aspect is bringing of persons into cooperative relationship with the organization. So there should be cooperation among all of them. So a cooperative relationship mein usko leke aao sare employees ko. This is the first aspect. And the second aspect is eliciting of services after they have been brought into relationship. So aap ek bar cooperation mein leke aa gaye, ab unki services aap lo, aap unse output nikalwao, theek hai? So eliciting of services after they have brought into relationship. So first bring them into a cooperative relationship and then bring them to give out the outputs, to elicit the services. This is nothing but you are securing the essential services from the individuals. These are achieved by maintaining morale and by providing incentives, deterrents, supervision, control, education and training. So how will you make your employees give output? You will make them by motivating them. And how will you motivating them? Increasing their morale by giving them incentives. We have learned them, right? General incentive hote hain, specific incentives hote hain, satisfaction contribution equilibrium hota hai. So you have to maintain all of these things, provide incentives, increase their morale, maintain some deterrents, you know, give some restriction and everything. So maintain some deterrents, give proper supervision, education, training. So all of these things help in ensuring or help in securing essential services from the members of the organization. This is the second task that you have to do, second essential task as an executive. The third essential task of an executive is formulation of purpose and objectives. So organization ka ya jo bhi purpose and objective hota hai ya jo bhi hai, wo formulate karna ek executive ka kaam hai. This is the third and the most important executive function. The third executive function is to formulate and define purpose, objectives and ends of the organization. To aap ek executive ho us organization ke, to ye aapka kaam hai us organization ka objective ko define karna, purpose define karna. This is the third important function that you have to perform. The purpose of the organization must be accepted by all the contributors to the system of efforts. To jo bhi contributors hain aapke system of efforts mein, yani ki aapke jo bhi members hain, employees hain, all of those employees should accept the purpose of organization. Purpose must be subdivided into fragments. To aisa nahi hai ki ek bada purpose bana ke de diya. It should be subdivided into fragments and specific objectives must reflect the detailed purposes and detailed actions. To har specific fragment ke liye aap define karo ki aapko isko kaise achieve karna hai. So every purpose must be subdivided into fragments and every fragment must be having a detailed action and detailed purpose in within itself. So this is what Chester Barnard said about purpose of the organization. I hope this is clear to you. The purpose can be geographic, social or functional. Purpose kuch bhi ho sakta hai. Geographical based purpose ho sakta hai ki humko is area mein serve karna hai apne customers ko, ya social based purpose ho sakta hai ki humko budde logon ko serve karna hai ya humko sirf bachchon ko serve karna hai, ya kuch functional based purpose ho sakta hai. So purpose can be anything, geographic, social or functional. And this is the most important part that Barnard says that executive is concerned with only the general part of the purpose. While you are formulating and defining the purpose of organization, as an executive you are concerned only with the general part of the purpose, only with the general and not with the specific parts. Okay, we'll see how an executive can accomplish and can do only that part of the purpose which relates to his position. So jo bhi uske position se relate karta hai, sirf usi part ka wo decision ya purpose define kar sakta hai. For example, if you are a manager, you cannot take into your hands what is relating to the CEO of the organization, that is relating to his position, right? So what is relating to your position, only that objective or purpose you will define. You will not accomplish or define anything that is not related to your position. This is the first thing. At every level below, purpose, objectives and direction get redefined with reference to that level, the time and the results to be accomplished. तो जो भी आप जैसे जैसे level नीचे जाओगे organization में, purpose gets redefined according to that level that you are in. For example, let's say you are in a shoe making factory. The overall goal of the organization is making shoes, but as you go down the levels, goal of that level might become making the sole of the shoes or making leather more shiny or whatever. So the purpose gets redefined. It is always in congruence with the overall organization goal. ठीक है, तो हमेशा वो congruence में रहेगा, but it will get redefined according to what level you are in. So at every level below, your purpose will get redefined and re-established. The purpose is defined in terms of specifications of the work to be done, and specifications are made when and where the work is being done. तो purpose कैसे define होता है? In terms of specifications of the work to be done. ठीक है, आपको जो भी काम करना है, उसके हिसाब से आप अपना purpose define करोगे. At all the levels below, right? If you are making sole of the shoes, you will define your purpose with respect to making sole of the shoes, right? So whatever work you have to do with regards to that, only specified to that purpose will be defined. So purpose are defined in terms of specifications of the work to be done, and these specifications are made when and where the work is being done. ठीक है, तो सोल मेकिंग वाले लेवल पे ही वो स्पेसिफिकेशन आएंगे. ठीक है, तो व्हेन एंड वेयर दोज वर्क्स आर टू बी डन, ओनली देयर यू हैव दोज स्पेसिफिकेशंस, एंड अकॉर्डिंग टू दोज स्पेसिफिकेशंस ओनली द पर्पस इज गेटिंग डिफाइंड. द फॉर्मुलेशन एंड डेफिनेशन ऑफ पर्पस इज अ वाइडली डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड फंक्शन एंड ओनली द जनरल पार्ट ऑफ विच इज एग्जीक्यूटिव. सो एज यू कैन सी बाय अबव पॉइंट्स, द फॉर्मुलेशन एंड डेफिनेशन ऑफ पर्पस इज अ वाइडली डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड फंक्शन. ठीक है, काफी डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड है वो. एट एवरी लेवल द पर्पस इज गेटिंग रीडिफाइंड, राइट? सो इट इज अ वेरी डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड फंक्शन, इट इज अ वाइडली डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड फंक्शन. सो वॉट एग्जीक्यूटिव इज कंसर्न इज विद ओनली द जनरल पार्ट. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, अ शू मेकिंग फैक्ट्री, वी हैव टू मेक शूज, दिस इज बींग डिफाइंड बाई एग्जीक्यूटिव एंड नॉट द स्पेसिफिक पर्पज दैट आर बींग डिफाइंड एट लोअर लेवल्स दैट द एग्जीक्यूटिव विल नॉट डिफाइन. दोज विल बी डिफाइंड बाई मैनेजर्स और एग्जीक्यूटिव एट दोज लेवल्स रिलेटेड टू देयर पोजिशन. आई होप दिस इज क्लियर टू यू दैट ओनली जनरल पार्ट इज कंसर्न विद द एग्जीक्यूटिव एंड नॉट द स्पेसिफिक पार्ट ऑफ द पर्पज. सो आई होप ऑल ऑफ द थ्री एग्जीक्यूटिव फंक्शंस आर क्लियर टू यू. फर्स्ट वॉज मेंटेनिंग एन ऑर्गेनाइजेशन कम्युनिकेशन, सेकेंड इज एंश्योरिंग ऑपरेशन और essential services from your individuals, and third is formulation of purpose and objectives. I hope these are clear to you. Now we'll move on to critical evaluation of Chester Barnard. We'll see how he is criticized and how he is significant still. So pay attention to this. The first criticism comes from Kenneth Andrew. Kenneth Andrew is the person who wrote introduction to the book Functions of the Executive. So Functions of the Executive mein jo introduction hai, that is written by Kenneth Andrew, and he himself has criticized Chester Barnard. We'll see how. Barnard was on his subjective experience. While it makes insightful analysis, it also works as a constraint. So what happens is, he is on a subjective experience. वो खुद के experience बना के एक book लिख दिया, बात खत्म. ठीक है, he did not conduct any experiments on a group of people, or he did not conduct any experiments in an organization, right? It is all his subjective experience. उसके खुद के view हैं. It is not an objective thing. It is a subjective experience that Barnard has given. While it makes his analysis insightful, उसका analysis काफी insightful हो जाता है. It is that, but it also works as a constraint. How? The theory does not provide a clue as for how this theory can be extended to various facets of organization of different types. तो जो भी organization of different types होते हैं, for example, public organizations, bureaucracy, Indian administration, or whatever different types of organizations you take, the theory of Chester Barnard does not provide a clue as to how his theory can be extended to these things. Now we have related some things here and there with our Indian administration, but the entire theory cannot be related, right? So this is the drawback, that this theory does not provide a clue as to how it can be extended to other organization of different types. Private organization mein hi kaam karta hai, theek hai? He further observes that Barnard has not dealt about the institutions of top management. So jara detail mein nahi gaya top management ke Chester Barnard. This is the next criticism that Kenneth Andrew gives. Barnard's definition of authority understates the role of objective authority and appears and assign individuals the choice of acceptance or rejection rather than participation. To ek objective authority naam ki bhi koi cheez hoti hai which you cannot reject. What Chester Barnard says is, every authority is based on acceptance basis, right? If you are accepting, only then the other person has authority on you. But there is also something known as objective authority. You cannot reject their objective authority because it is applicable to all. If you are working in an organization and there is a CEO of the organization, that CEO is superior to you. He has an authority which should be accepted by you. That cannot be rejected by you. That you cannot say that you are not my CEO. My CEO is my father. You cannot say that, right? So there are some objective relative authority concepts that Chester Barnard has not dealt with, or he understates them. He has dealt with them. He has given the concept of subjective and objective aspects of authority. If you remember, we have discussed this. But he understates the role of objective authority because he says that authority is only based on acceptance basis. And he gives the choice of acceptance or rejection rather than participation, because as a member of the organization, your job is participation and your job is not rejection or acceptance. Your job is participation. He considers the abstractness of the presentation, the paucity. The paucity means slow pace of the telling of the book. So the presentation, the paucity, and the pedestrian quality of examples, and the difficult style, the main weakness of the book. So what are the main weakness of the book? The difficult style of writing and the paucity, presentation, and most important, pedestrian quality of examples. Now I have not given you these examples, but Chester Barnard has given these examples of a boy and an apple. If a boy wants to eat an apple, he wants to eat only the apple that has fallen from the tree and not what the apple that mother gives him from the fruit basket of their kitchen. So these are some pedestrian kind of examples, you know, bahut hi chalu example diye. So pedestrian quality of examples in pure book mein all of the examples are pedestrian quality examples. So this is the next criticism that Kenneth Andrew gives. But in counter of this, you can counter this point of pedestrian quality of examples by saying that Barnard, who is conscious of this limitation of less practical examples, Barnard himself was conscious of this thing. He did not deny that my examples are very superior. He was conscious of this thing that his examples have limited practical experience. He feels that in theorizing and when it is being addressed to so many groups of widely different attitudes and experience, a certain amount of abstractness is inevitable. He gracefully accepts the deficiency of not providing practical examples. So he says that meri book jo hai wo itne sare log padhenge, pedestrian log bhi padhenge, layman log bhi padhenge, who do not understand superior English, those people will also read my book. So that is why I have given pedestrian examples, and I accept this fact. I know this is a limitation, and I accept this with graceful attitude that this is a deficiency of my book. So he has accepted himself. He knows that it is a limitation, so you cannot criticize him on this fact, right? So this is a counter that you can give. Barnard was aware of this. It's not like he was not aware of this and usne aise galti se de diye, or he was not so much intellect. He was aware that his examples are of pedestrian quality. This is the counter that you can give. The second criticism that we'll learn is Barnard's theory, while focuses its attention on cooperative effort, it does not adequately deal with creative development of our individual. So cooperative effort pe itna focus kiya hai, lekin creative development of our individual pe bilkul focus nahi kiya. So how should a individual develop creatively? Because there should be an overall development of individuals, right? You are analyzing the behavior of human beings, and you are not saying how you should develop the human beings. You are just giving four specific inducements and four general inducements to motivate the employees. That is okay. But as an human being, if you are working in an organization, and as a scholar, if you are analyzing human behavior, it is your job to analyze how a human being can be developed overall. So there should be a creative development of individual, and this is not focused on by Chester Barnard. Next criticism is, nor does it deal with the question as to under what conditions individual develop commitment to the organization and how such commitment gets strengthened. So ek commitment wali cheez hoti hai na, loyalty wali cheez hoti hai. Under what conditions you cooperate, that is fine. That is Chester Barnard has dealt with, under what conditions you cooperate and all those things. But there is also a thing of commitment, a loyalty to organization. Chester Barnard does not tell under what conditions employees become loyal to their organization. So this commitment factor is lacking in his theory. I hope these criticisms are getting clear to you. These are very important criticisms. Freedom to reject authority is the next criticism. In a society where the range of alternatives is large, that is capitalist society, individuals may enjoy relative freedom, but where the opportunities are restricted, that is feudal or underdeveloped nations, the individual has no freedom to reject authority. So what he says is, all of his theory of authority he has based on the basis of acceptance. If you remember, acceptance was the basis of his theory of authority. So what is criticized here is that it is true for some developed nations, some capitalist nations, ठीक है? तो developed nations और capitalist nations में ये ठीक है कि उनको freedom होगी authority को reject करने की, but if you consider some underdeveloped nations or some feudal nations, तो ऐसे nations में individuals को ज़्यादा freedom नहीं होता है authority को reject करने का. You cannot reject orders because of restricted opportunities, because in these countries, in underdeveloped countries, the opportunities are restricted. So you cannot just deny authority every time, because you have to earn, right? Pay डेट भी तो भरना है, जिंदा भी तो रहना है. सो अपॉर्चुनिटीज आर रेस्ट्रिक्टेड, सो फ्रीडम टू रिजेक्ट अथॉरिटी इज ऑल्सो लेस. सो दिस इज नॉट एप्लीकेबल अक्रॉस द ग्लोब और अक्रॉस द टाइम एंड प्लेस. इट इज वेरी रेस्ट्रिक्टेड थियरी ऑफ एक्सेप्टेंस दैट इज लिमिटेड ओनली टू डेवलप्ड नेशंस और लार्ज नेशंस और कैपिटलिस्ट नेशंस एंड नॉट टू एनी डेवलप्ड नेशंस. आई होप दिस इज क्लियर टू यू. दिस इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट क्रिटिसिजम ऑफ फ्रीडम ऑफ रिजेक्शन ऑफ अथॉरिटी, बिकॉज एक्सेप्टेंस एज द बेसिस इज अ गुड बेसिस. डू नॉट टेक मी रॉन्ग, इट इज अ वेरी वेरी गुड बेसिस बिकॉज इट गिव्स अ प्रॉपर रेलेवेंस टू द अथॉरिटी, राइट. बट इट इज नॉट एप्लीकेबल एवरीवेयर. अंडर डेवलप्ड नेशंस में आप जाओगे तो उधर उनको उतनी फ्रीडम नहीं होती है रिजेक्ट करने की अथॉरिटी. सो दिस इज नॉट एप्लीकेबल एवरीवेयर. सो वी आर डन विद क्रिटिसिजम्स. नाउ वी विल सी हाउ चेस्टर बर्नार्ड इज सिग्निफिकेंट इन टूडेज टाइम्स. चेस्टर बर्नार्ड्स 1938 क्लासिक वर्क द फंक्शंस ऑफ द एग्जीक्यूटिव इटसेल्फ इज एन इंपॉर्टेंट कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन टू द मैनेजमेंट और ऑर्गेनाइजेशन. सो हिज वर्क इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन. वी ऑल्सो नेम इज एज फोर रनर ऑफ बिहेवियरल अप्रोच, इफ यू रिमेंबर. सो हिज वर्क इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन. इन द ओपिनियन ऑफ पीटर्स एंड वॉटरमैन, दीज आर टू पीपल हु रोट अ बुक एंड इन देयर बुक दे हैव रिकॉग्नाइज्ड बर्नार्ड. दे से दैट बर्नार्ड्स बुक प्रोवाइडेड प्रोबेबली द फर्स्ट बैलेंस्ड ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ द मैनेजमेंट प्रोसेस. सो दिस इज हाउ ही इज सिग्निफिकेंट. इट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट हिज थियरी, वॉट एवर ही इज गिवन, इट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एंड वी कैन रिलेट टू इट इन टूडेज टाइम्स. ओके, सो दिस पॉइंट नाउ लेट मी रीड इट आउट. आई विल एक्सप्लेन दिस पॉइंट एंड दिस पॉइंट विल बी यूज इन 2015 क्वेश्चंस अगेन, विच आई हैव बीन सेइंग थ्रू आउट द सेशन. देर वॉज वन ट्रिकी 2015 क्वेश्चन रिलेटेड टू चेस्टर बर्नार्ड. विल यूज दिस पॉइंट ओवर देयर. सो प्लीज पे अटेंशन. इट कैन बी प्रॉपरली कंसिडर्ड एज अ मेजर कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन टू द ओपन मॉडल ऑर्गेनाइजेशन. बर्नार्ड प्रेजेंट्स अ सिस्टम्स अप्रोच टू द स्टडी ऑफ ऑर्गेनाइजेशन विच कंटेन्स अ साइकोलॉजिकल थियरी ऑफ मोटिवेशन एंड बिहेवियर, अ सोशियोलॉजिकल थियरी ऑफ कॉपरेशन एंड कॉम्प्लेक्स इंटरडिपेंडेंसीज एंड एन आइडियोलॉजी बेस्ड ऑन अ मेरिटोक्रेसी. सो वॉट वी आर ट्राइंग टू से हियर इज वी हैव नॉट लर्नड अबाउट सिस्टम्स अप्रोच एज ऑफ नाउ. सो आई विल जस्ट एक्सप्लेन टू यू इन ब्रीफ वॉट सिस्टम्स अप्रोच मीन्स. देर आर टू काइंड ऑफ सिस्टम्स दैट वी से, वन इज ओपन मॉडल सिस्टम एंड वन इज क्लोज मॉडल सिस्टम. सो वॉट इज ओपन मॉडल सिस्टम इज वेरी सिंपल. ऑर्गेनाइजेशन इज कनेक्टेड टू द सोसाइटी. वी हैव डेल्ट विद दिस आइडिया. वी हैव नॉट डेल्ट विद द टर्म ओपन मॉडल एज सच. ओके, वी हैव डेल्ट विद दिस आइडिया दैट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन आर कनेक्टेड टू द सोसाइटी. सोसाइटी में कुछ उथल पुथल हो रही है तो ऑर्गेनाइजेशन के अंदर भी वो अफेक्ट करेगा, बिकॉज ह्यूमन बींग्स हु आर वर्किंग इन एन ऑर्गेनाइजेशन आर अ पार्ट ऑफ सोसाइटी इट्सेल्फ. सो इफ देर आर राइट्स हैपनिंग इन सोसाइटी, इफ देर आर क्लैशेज बिटवीन डिफरेंट ग्रुप्स ऑफ पीपल हैपनिंग इन अ सोसाइटी, इट विल ऑब्वियसली अफेक्ट द इंटरनल वर्किंग ऑफ द ऑर्गेनाइजेशन ऑल्सो, बिकॉज ह्यूमन बींग्स आर अ पार्ट ऑफ सोसाइटी, राइट. सो दिस इज नथिंग बट ओपन मॉडल ऑर्गेनाइजेशन सिस्टम, विच इज नथिंग बट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन इज ओपन, इट इज कनेक्टेड टू द सोसाइटी. आई होप यू अंडरस्टैंड दिस. एंड अनदर वन इज क्लोज सिस्टम मॉडल. क्लोज सिस्टम मॉडल इज नथिंग बट वट एवर इज हैपनिंग इन सोसाइटी डज नॉट अफेक्ट the organization, and this is not true. Closed system model is a model, but this is not true, as we all know, right? Because every organization is an open model. So there are two types of systems approach. So what we are trying to say here, significance of Barnard's theory is that Barnard presents a systems approach. Systems approach came much later than Barnard. Okay, Barnard ke time pe systems approach bilkul nahi tha, but what Barnard gave us as a theory, it can be considered as a first approach to systems approach. Theek hai, aisa pehla aadmi tha jisne agar systems approach ko haath lagaya hai, we can say that is Chester Barnard. And what examples can you give of this from the theory of Chester Barnard? If you remember, while understanding the behavior of human beings, Chester Barnard had said that there are two kinds of aspects that you can consider. One is inside the organization aspect of human being and one is outside the organization aspect of human being. And outside the organization is always opposed to inside the organization aspect, if you remember these things. So he has considered connection with the society. So it is a first approach to systems approach what Chester Barnard gave us. So you can say this because his study contains a psychological theory of motivation and behavior. आप motivate कर रहे हो लोगों को, उनका behavior analyze कर रहे हो, तो obviously आप उनकी society से उनका connection देख रहे हो. Otherwise, how you will motivate on social factors, right? Social and psychological factors पे आप motivate तभी करोगे when you are considering the society, right? So you have considered motivation and everything. A sociological theory of cooperation. Cooperation आप करवा रहे हो, complex interdependencies आप बोल रहे हो, everything is complex, so complex. So everything is connected with the society. If you are analyzing in detail, Chester Barnard has said that organization is connected with the society. He did not say it so much explicitly, but he said it so much implicitly. So you have to remember this, that his approach or his theory is significant because it is the first approach towards the systems approach. Moving on to next significance, his idea of organization as a cooperative social system challenged Max Weber's theory of organization as bureaucracy. Cooperation as a basis of necessity of human life and as the cause of human development is profoundly elucidated by Chester Barnard. So obviously Max Weber was a classical theorist, so he did not consider behavior of human beings in bureaucracy and everything, right? So what Chester Barnard did was he challenged Max Weber's theory. This you can write in significance. So try to relate these things. Also, Chester Barnard profoundly explained what cooperation means as a basic necessity of human life. We have seen what human beings cannot achieve individually, they achieve them by cooperation. The very very first slide, if you remember, organization as a cooperative system, this is what we learned in that slide, that basic necessity of human life is cooperation. Free choice does not exist. Cooperation is the basic necessity of human life and it is the cause of human development. If you have to develop, you will have to cooperate, and this is the very important idea that Chester Barnard gave us. So this is how his theory is significant. Barnard was one of the pioneers of behavioral movement in public administration. We have seen this. He was one of the forerunners of behavioral approach, right? We have seen this many times. His approach to organization can be called behavioral because he laid emphasis on social psychological aspects of management in organization. He influenced Herbert Simon, who developed Barnard's ideas further. So Herbert Simon was also influenced by Chester Barnard. So he was one of the forerunners of behavioral movement. Barnard challenged F.W. Taylor's belief and classical approach on the whole by dismantling the economic man concept. We have seen this, that he completely rejected the economic man concept. He said that man is not motivated by money alone. It is one of the factors, but not money alone. He gave us 8 type of inducements. 4 are specific inducements and 4 are general inducements, if you remember. So he challenged F.W. Taylor's idea and all of the classical approach idea on the whole by dismantling and rejecting the economic man concept. This is how his theory is significant. Barnard's concept of authority provided the foundation for the present day acceptance theory of authority. So aaj bhi hum mante hain ki authority should be based on acceptance. So Barnard laid the foundation for this. Barnard laid the foundation for the present day acceptance theory of authority. He was also one of the first to study process of decision making in organizations. We have seen this, what Barnard said on decision making in organizations, and this is the first person. He is the first person to study decision making in organization. After him came Herbert Simon. Herbert Simon gave us a better decision making model. We will study this in Herbert Simon session, but Chester Barnard was the first session to study the decision making in organizations. His analysis of process of formal and informal organization and their mutual interaction has practical utility and scientific value to everyone interested in understanding social problems. So if you are a person who has to understand social problems, agar aap ek sociologist ho, agar aapko social problems ko padhne mein maza aata hai, unko understand karne mein maza aata hai, if you like reading and understanding social problems, his theory becomes important for you. His analysis of process of formal and informal organizations become important to you if you have to understand social problems. So this is the significance of Chester Barnard's theory. So moving on, we'll move on to some practice questions, and as always I will request you to please practice this, because only by practice you will know where you are lacking and what will happen at the max. You will go wrong, right? You will not be able to write the answer. That is the maximum thing that can happen, but what will emerge out of it is a more confident part of you, which will be able to tackle any kind of questions. So I have included one UPSC and many non-UPSC questions, so please kindly practice this. So one UPSC question that we'll study is, okay, I'm sorry for this, this is UPSC 2015, not 2016, okay, this is UPSC 2015 question. I'm sorry for this. The question is, contemporary organizational theory seems further afield of Chester Barnard's functions of the executive than of organizational ecology. Examine the statement in the light of ecological elements of Barnard's thoughts. This was asked for 15 marks. What I would ask you is, pause this video for 2 seconds or 5 seconds and read the question, and you try to understand. Now we have learnt all about Chester Barnard, everything we have learnt, and I can assure you this question is very simple. Pause the video and try to understand the question, and I will give you some time for that. So as you can see, the question is not very much in clear terms. It is very ambiguous in its language, right? So what it says is, try to understand the basic idea what the question is asking you to do, okay? So try to break into different parts. So first part is contemporary organizational theory. So there is some contemporary organizational theory that you have to deal with. What it is, we'll see in the question. So some contemporary organizational theory, jo aaj ki jo organizational theory hain, jo contemporary chal rahi hain, those theories seem further afield of Chester Barnard's functions of the executive than of द ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल इकोलॉजी. तो जो चेस्टर बर्नार्ड ने जो फंक्शंस ऑफ द एग्जीक्यूटिव की जो थियरी दी है उससे काफ़ी दूर हैं, आज की जो ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल थियरी है उससे काफ़ी दूर हैं देन ऑफ द ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल इकोलॉजी. तो यहाँ पे है ना तीन थियरी की बात हो रही है. फर्स्ट थियरी आर कंटेम्प्रेरी ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल थियरीज, दिस इज द फर्स्ट थियरी दैट द क्वेश्चन इज टॉकिंग अबाउट. सेकेंड थियरी द क्वेश्चन इज टॉकिंग अबाउट इज चेस्टर बर्नार्ड्स फंक्शंस ऑफ द एग्जीक्यूटिव. थर्ड थियरी दैट द क्वेश्चन इज टॉकिंग अबाउट इज ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल इकोलॉजी थियरी. सो व्हाट द क्वेश्चन इज सेइंग दैट आजकल की जो कंटेम्प्रेरी ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल थियरी हैं दोज आर मोर क्लोज टू ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल इकोलॉजी एंड दे आर अ फील्ड ऑफ चेस्टर बर्नार्ड्स फंक्शंस ऑफ द एग्जीक्यूटिव. आई होप यू अंडरस्टैंड दिस थिंग नाउ. सो जो ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल इकोलॉजी की जो थियरी है दैट इज मोर इक्वल टू कंटेम्प्रेरी ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल थियरी एंड चेस्टर बर्नार्ड की थियरी आजकल की थियरी से मैच नहीं करती. सो आई विल रीड द स्टेटमेंट वंस अगेन. कंटेम्प्रेरी ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल थियरी सीम्स फर्दर अ फील्ड ऑफ चेस्टर बर्नार्ड्स फंक्शंस ऑफ द एग्जीक्यूटिव देन ऑफ ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल इकोलॉजी. एग्जामिन द स्टेटमेंट इन द लाइट ऑफ इकोलॉजिकल स्टेटमेंट्स इन बर्नार्ड्स थॉट. नाउ इफ यू विल रीड एनी रेफरेंस बुक, आप प्रसादन प्रसाद पढ़ लो या आप मोहित भट्टाचार्य पढ़ लो, आप कोई भी रेफरेंस बुक पढ़ लो, आपको किसी भी रेफरेंस बुक में इकोलॉजिकल एलिमेंट्स इन बर्नार्ड्स थॉट नहीं मिलेगा, बिल्कुल नहीं मिलेगा. Only you have to infer it from what he has said. Okay, so whatever he has said you have to infer it. So first of all, what is organizational ecology theory? Ecology theory is a very big theory. We will study it in comparative public administration module. ठीक है, comparative administration module का एक part है ecology study of administration. तो what is ecology study of administration? It consists of many things. It consists of politics, it consists of sociology, psychology और बहुत सारे dimension होते हैं. A very basic example that I can give you is very recent. 2008 का जो फाइनेंशियल क्राइसिस हुआ था, दोज क्राइसिस कैन बी स्टडीड विद रिस्पेक्ट टू ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल इकोलॉजी. एज यू कैन सी इट हैड अ वेरी ग्लोबल इम्पैक्ट. ठीक है, तो ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल इकोलॉजी एक इतनी ग्लोबल टाइप ऑफ थियरी है. इट स्टडीज एवरी थिंग वॉट इज हैपनिंग इन द सोसाइटी, इट स्टडीज एवरी थिंग एंड इट रिलेट्स विद वॉट इज हैपनिंग इन साइड द ऑर्गेनाइजेशन. तो पूरे ग्लोबल लेवल पर भी पॉलिटिक्स का भी सीन और जो भी सारे सीन्स हैं, एवरी थिंग इज कंसिडर्ड बाई दिस इकोलॉजी. इकोलॉजी थियरी इज अ वेरी बिग थियरी एंड वॉट चेस्टर बर्नार्ड हैज गिवन इज नॉट सो वेरी बिग, राइट? उसने सोसाइटी के साथ डील किया है. वी हैव सीन दिस दैट चेस्टर बर्नार्ड हैज डेल्ट विद टू एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ ह्यूमन beings, one is inside the organization and outside the organization also, and while making decision making also we should consider social and psychological factors. I have said this, if you remember, while making decisions, decision makers are affected by social and psychological factors. So these are all something which are connected to society, right? तो लेकिन उतना भी बड़ा नहीं है जितना ecology है. इसमें political aspect नहीं आता है, ecology theory में political aspect आता है. ठीक है, so if you study organizational ecology, political aspects are there and all the things are there, but Chester Bernard's theory is dealing with ecological aspects, no doubt, but वो organizational ecology theory जो है उससे compare नहीं कर पाती है. तो आजकल की जो theories हैं वो organizational ecology theory हैं, but Chester Bernard की जो theory है वो उतनी सोसाइटी के साथ रिलेट नहीं कर पाती है. इट डज रिलेट एंड यू हैव टू एम्फेसाइज ऑन दिस थिंग. यू हैव टू एम्फेसाइज इन द लाइट ऑफ इकोलॉजिकल एलिमेंट्स इन बर्नार्ड थॉट इफ यू कैन सी द क्वेश्चन. सो नो क्वेश्चन इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट. माई पॉइंट इज नो क्वेश्चन इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट. इन दिस क्वेश्चन यू जस्ट हैव टू क्रिटिसाइज चेस्टर बर्नार्ड्स इकोलॉजिकल कंसेप्ट. ओके, एज अ बिहेवियरल थिंकर हिज वर्क वॉज टू कंसिडर इकोलॉजी ऑन अ वेरी बिग स्केल, बट ही डिड नॉट डू सो. बट ही डिड ऑन सम स्केल, बट ही डिड नॉट डू सो ऑन सम बिग स्केल. एंड कंटेम्प्रेरी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन थियरीज आर फर्दर अ फील्ड ऑफ चेस्टर Bernard's functions of the executive then of the organizational ecology. So basically you have to criticize Chester Bernard based on his ecological concepts. So ye bahut hi basic idea hai question ka. Agar aapko ye malum padega, you can write this for 15 marks, you can write anything in this answer. So I want you to write this answer also. Please practice this question also and other questions also. This was in UPSC 15. Again, sorry for this thing. It was for 15 marks. And also practice these questions. If not all, at least practice some of these questions and try to see that where you are lacking. So with this thought, I thank you for listening to my rant. And if you like the content that I have given you, please like the video, comment on the video and share the video. Also subscribe to the channel if you have not done so already. Hope to see you soon in my next session. Peace out.